So Carol is the non-game wildlife program supervisor. I think you've been there for like 1977, is that what I read? Okay. Like I said, he's a rock star. He does all of his work with the DNR. He writes books for the DNR, Lakescaping for Wildlife and Water Quality. Many years with these awards programs, we would give that out as part of the prizes. He wrote Woodworking for Wildlife. He's also done a lot of other books on bird watching and trips to Costa Rica. But he's the guy who knows about loons, and he's going to talk to us about Minnesota loons, which spend their winters down in the Gulf of Mexico, which are being impacted by the Deepwater Horizon oil spill that happened there a few years ago. And I believe there's some money coming from BP to go towards some of the loon work that's being done here in Minnesota because our loons are being affected by them. So why don't we bring Carol up here, and why don't you help me give him a warm welcome.
Thank you very much, Bill, and thank you for the invitation to join you today. This has been a wonderful annual event. I've been here several times and spoken in earlier versions of the presentations. But when we get people involved with protecting and restoring lakeshores, that's a very precious resource in Minnesota. And we need more people to set that example on how we can protect our water quality, lakeshores, and aquatic environments throughout the state. So you are leading the charge, and I sincerely appreciate that. And what I'd like to do today is to give you a lot of information about what we've been doing since 2010 to study the problem that resulted from the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. And in May of 2010, Senator Klobuchar convened a meeting in St. Paul from conservation groups, biologists, conservation organizations to say what species of wildlife that are migratory from Minnesota might have been affected by the oil spill, because all of the focus was on the wildlife killed from the Gulf Coast states. And we put together a working group over a couple month period. And the two species that came right to the top were the common loon and the American white pelican, because they winter in the Gulf. The loons, when they hatch here, they go down to the Gulf. They don't come back to Minnesota until they're 3 years old. So we knew that we had loons down there when the spill occurred. And the white pelicans don't come back to Minnesota until they're 2 years old. So those birds are also in the Gulf, and we're in the Gulf at the time of the spill. Yes?
Can you say that one more time?
Yes. They hatch here. They migrate south their first fall. They don't come back to Minnesota until their spring of their third year. They usually don't start breeding until they're five. And then they might live until they're 25 years old. So they have a very complex life schedule. And so what we wanted to do is to follow up with Senator Klobuchar's recommendation that we take a look at this. And we put together a proposal to the LCCMR, the Legislative Citizens Commission on Minnesota Resources. And this is the combination of private citizens and legislators who allocate about $50 million each year from the state lottery for conservation projects. And they were very supportive of this proposal. And since 2011 and ending this June 30th, we've received $651,000 through those lottery funds through the, it's called the Environment and Natural Resources Trust Fund. So that's a very important source of funding for conservation in Minnesota. Without that, this never would have happened. So we appreciate the LCCMR and the work that they do to allocate those funds. And one of the reasons that Minnesota came to the top of the considerations here is that we have about 12,000 loons in the state. Next in line is Wisconsin with about 3,400, and Michigan has maybe 7,800, something like that. Only Alaska has more, but the Alaska loons were not some of the victims of the oil spill. This is the result of the common moon distribution data that was collected by Audubon, Minnesota over 5 years to determine where loons are breeding. They were confirmed on those orange squares and possible and probable were green and blue. So you can see they're all the way down even south of the Twin Cities, down through Lakeville and up through the Arrowhead and then up through central Minnesota, the Lakes Country, and right here around Brainerd and Crow Wing County. We're kind of the heart of good loon country conservation areas here. So this is very timely information that helped us, because what we had to do is to link the fate of Minnesota's loons with what happened in the oil spill to show that Minnesota's loons were some of the loons most affected by the spill. So the Deepwater Horizon spill ironically occurred on Earth Day, April 22nd, on 2010. It continued to the middle of July. Almost 5 million barrels of oil were spilled. And then there were 800,000 to a million gallons of what was called dispersant dumped on the oil. And when they say dispersant, you kind of think, well, that must break the oil down, so that wouldn't be so damaging. No, it just made the oil sink from the surface, so if you were flying an airplane trying to see how big the spill was and where it was, you couldn't see anymore. It was just floating around in the Gulf in a big blob below the surface. And then eventually it would have settled to the bottom. So this is a map of the initial area affected by the oil spill. And then the oil floated eastwards towards Florida Panhandle and western coast of Florida. And of course, you saw the news coverage at the time of all the wildlife species that were affected along the Gulf Coast states. So they are the ones that were most affected in terms of local wildlife in the Gulf of Mexico. But then, thanks to Senator Klobuchar, we made a statement that migratory wildlife was also an important victim that needed to be considered in terms of what was its federal legislation, the Oil Pollution Act of 1980, which said that whenever there's an oil spill, the damages and wildlife killed have to be paid back by the responsible company to essentially restore the wildlife that was killed. And in terms of the Fish and Wildlife Service, they have some interesting math they do trying to figure out, okay, well, how much is a loon worth? Well, you know what they came up with? $35,000 per loon. And there were nearly 1,000 loons that got oiled to death in that spill. So that's why they have to look at all the species killed, assign a value, and then say, we need to work with the responsible states where those wildlife species came from to help restore the ones that were killed. Pardon?
The LCC, is that who you said
assigned that $35,000? No, that's just a value that the Fish and Wildlife Service assigns, and it's part of the math that they do in terms of coming up with restoration strategies. This is where, before the oil spill, we had band recoveries of loons from Minnesota. Most of them were off the Florida Panhandle and the west coast of Florida, down into the Florida Keys, a few offshore from North and South Carolina, but most of them were within the Gulf and offshore from Alabama south to the Keys. But we needed more information than that to really provide the linkage between the spill and Minnesota's loons. And thankfully, we were able to put together a wonderful team. Good conservation doesn't occur with single groups or persons, and just like you know with your local organization here, teamwork goes a long way. The networking between people power, funding, and enthusiasm, it all comes together to make good things happen. That's what we try to do here. We were looking at 6 different items: migration patterns, wintering areas, diving behavior, oil contaminants, population trends, and then NARDAR. Of those federal acronyms that we have to put up with: natural resource damage and restoration. Our partners with the DNR Non-Game Program, You know that program? Because when you do your taxes, that's that friendly little line with the loon on it. Well, that's my line. We get about $1 million a year that is contributed by Minnesota citizens like yourself on the tax form. And one of the best things now is that money that comes from conservation license plates matches that dollar for dollar. So the $1 million that we receive from private citizens becomes another $1 million from the license plate fund. So now we got $2 million. And this past month, by May 15th, I submitted a proposal to the LCCMR to challenge them to also match our checkoff donations one-to-one every year. So that would be an additional $1 million for biolic projects that has to go before the LCCMR and get approved by the legislature next year. And with that, we would have the incredible ability to do a lot of projects, not only to look after loons, but a lot of other wildlife. We also have University of Connecticut. They're the ones doing the assessment of contaminants in the loons, also in pelicans, because they were doing the analysis for the other organizations that were sampling wildlife in the Gulf of Mexico, because we wanted all these results to be comparable. We didn't want them being done by different labs. And then the U.S. Geological Survey in La Crosse has been exceptional. They have the team that is able to capture the loons and outfit them with satellite transmitters, geolocators, take blood samples, and all of this is done from about 10 o'clock at night until 4 o'clock in the morning, night after night. And it's been one of the most exciting parts of my job over the last 6 years. Just flip my schedule upside down and go out at 10 at night and get done just as the sun is coming up. And to experience Minnesota's lake. Now, the lakes are beautiful in the daytime. You know what? You go out in the middle of the night, you're the only one there, you're just listening to the loons, seeing falling stars. It's incredible. And then Wisconsin DNR, they have staff people who are doing necropsies on loons that are found dead by private citizens like yourself. The loon floats up, we get it picked up, freeze it, ship it over there. We get about 25 to 30 loons per year, and we get them analyzed for the cause of death. There's three main reasons that loons die. One of them is that they get run over by boats, power boats, because people are not looking where they're going. The two worst weekends of the year for loons are Memorial Day weekend and 4th of July weekend, because that's when the lakes are just swamped with boaters not looking both ways for the loons. The second reason is that they die from swallowing lead jigs and sinkers from fishing tackle, because when someone loses their tackle and falls to the bottom, and if this is a hard bottom lake, hard sand, or whatever, loons have to pick up maybe a couple dozen little pieces of gravel about a quarter inch in diameter to grind up the minnows that they need. And if they pick up a lead split shot or a piece of a lead jig, a little jig, all it takes is one split shot of lead to kill the loon. And there's a lot of non-toxic fishing tackle now being produced, even by Minnesota manufacturers. But the sporting goods stores have not done a good job to promote this or put it out where people can find it. You have to go in and really bug them about, okay, where's your non-toxic tackle? I want some lead, I want some non-lead jigs and sinkers. If enough people start insisting on this, maybe we can push that envelope into the future and get lead out of the fishing tackle. So far, we've not made much progress. Yes? Initially, it has been more costly, but if we can drive up the demand, it's going to put the price down so it's comparable. And the problem is that the cost of the lead in terms of the negative impact it has on fish and wildlife has never been factored in to the price of what's happening. You know, when people pay less for lead, but they don't see the loons dying, or say, well, I never saw one, so it can't be a problem. Yeah. And then, of course, the LCCMR, their funding. Well, this is our team. Our first goal was to determine loon migration patterns, because we wanted to know if they were migrating to the spots that were most affected by the oil and the oil settling to the bottom. So we're gonna do that with satellite telemetry. But you can't use a backpack transmitter on a Luma because it would impede their ability to dive, swim, and catch fish. So we have to do an internal implant. So we had to find a transmitter that could be implanted in the abdominal cavity without hurting the loon, and then give us a chance to track it wherever it goes. Well, we used Argos receivers and transmitters. These are accurate to within 250 meters anywhere on Earth. There's nowhere that loon can go that we can't find it now. Well, this is one of our summer crews from 2014, and they were capturing loons all the way up from the northeast angle, all the way west to Park Rapids area, south down to Anoka County. We wanted to make sure that the loons, throughout the range of the loon, were all being studied objectively. So we would head out at sunset. I wasn't there for all the nights, but I went out enough nights to get a pretty good feel for what was happening. And the way that you catch the loons is that you find a pair that's got chicks, and then you get within the territory of the loons. You play the call of a chick in distress, and the parents swim right up to the boat wondering where Junior is. And then you just scoop it up with a big salmon landing net. So there's one very surprised loon thinking, where's the chick? And you have to be very careful holding it by the neck so it doesn't stab you, because that bill is very sharp and could be quite an injury. So once the loon is captured, then it's brought ashore and it's run through a series of measurements. It's weighed. This is an interesting one from Lake George in Anoka County. It has iron staining on the breast, kind of like the sandhill crane. You can see cranes is reddish over the head. It's the iron from the water and the mud. So the loon is banded in the Fish and Wildlife Service bands. And then a blood sample is taken. And with this, we can put it through testing for the petroleum and dispersant contaminants. A little spot of blood is put on a piece of paper, and this can be analyzed to determine the sex of the loon, because at a distance, you really can't tell. And then one feather was taken from the underwing of each loon, also for contaminant testing. And then a data sheet was filled out for each one. So there were detailed records for every bird. And then they had a special, like a mobile surgery trailer, 30-foot trailer brought up from Florida to do the operations on the loon. And this is Daryl Hurd. He is a surgeon who specializes in satellite transmitters for seabirds. He's the eiders, scoters, loons, never lost a patient. So he puts the bird under, and this is a transmitter about the size of your thumb, weighs 64 grams, and it's placed in the abdominal cavity, and then a tiny little hole is poked in the top of the pelvic girdle. Now these transmitters are programmed for each season to give different rates of transmitting. So we get the most data when we need the most data, which is like fall migration and spring migration, where we get data for 8 hours on, 24 off. They go until just maybe 2.5 years, and then they run out of juice. So the little transmitter is inserted into the abdominal cavity, and that tiny little hole I told you about, the antenna comes out the top of the pelvic girdle, so it looks like a radio-controlled loon. Now we did this with a total of 15 adult loons 2010 and 11, and then we did it with 22 loons in 2014 and 15. The juvenile loons had never ever been studied like this before. This was brand new information to science, and it was pretty exciting. I'll show you what we found. So this is the antenna, about 8 inches long. It doesn't hurt the loon, it doesn't impede their flight or swimming or preening.
Huh?
No, sometimes they get bent over time. I saw one this spring, and then it's in a bent side.
You don't get an infection where it comes through the...
No, it just seals over. So then the loon is taken back out to its territory and released after it's been put through this little operation. And these knots all over from the northeast all the way down through central Minnesota are all the different loons that were treated, outfitted with transmitters. And then also later on in the project, we started adding geolocator tags, and I'll explain that in a little bit. Now, if you'd like to check this out and see what happened with all that data, the USGS has a website, and you can go back and it'll show you the history of all these loons that were hooked up with transmitters. And the way that I find it most easily is I just type in USGS, comma, loon tracking. And then you pull up this web page, and then you can retrieve the data. For example, if you hit play animation and it shows you how the loons migrate. Like, this is the migratory path of a single loon from Minnesota. Oops. Okay, here, this is what we found with the adult loons. First they went over to the upper end of Lake Michigan. This is mid-September. They're feeding on the bottom of Lake Michigan, like 120 or 30 feet down on the bottom. Now we're getting into late October, and you can see the dots moving down, some into Lake Huron, Lake Erie, but now most of the loons are going to the south end of Lake Michigan, and they're feeding at 150 feet deep on round gobies, which are an invasive species, which I don't know how that happens, but anyway, they're devouring them. Now you can see we're first week of December, they're skipping the country, they're heading to the beach. Now the adult loons go far offshore, and they're not in breeding plumage, and they don't call them because they don't have the same appeal in winter that they do in Minnesota. They're not calling, they don't look like a loon, they look like a gray seabird, and they're way out in the ocean. During the course of the winter, they just kind of move up and down the coast. And then here we're in March, whoops, time to go north. And you can see they're hopscotching over a couple day period back up to the Great Lakes. By early April, they start to come back into Minnesota. And they have some birds they also marked in Wisconsin. So we have birds from both states as part of this study. Now we're in May 10th, and now the birds are back on territory. They come back to the same lake that they were on the year before. If they lose a mate, they'll still come back to the same lake.
They'll take another mate.
In fact, in Wisconsin, they did a study because there are these floater loons that are looking for love and they haven't found it yet. Males, they fly over a lake, and if the male on the water calls, and he has a higher pitched voice than the loon in the air, the loon in the air knows he can take him out. And then they have a big fight. Sometimes they even die from fighting. And that's one of the other reasons that loons die, is that they have these intraspecific conflicts where they fight over territories. And when they stab another loon, sometimes it's fatal.
The
pitch of the voice. If the male that's looking for a mate has a deeper voice, a deeper call, it's apparently bigger, stronger, and more aggressive, and he'll take on that loon that's got the mate. So what we found out with the loons is that they winter primarily offshore from the coast of Alabama, Gulf Coast, Panhandle of Florida, and down along the west coast of the few birds on the upper end of Florida and from North Carolina. Now, what this means from the standpoint of the oil spill is that those light blue circles are superimposed over where the oil would have settled. So we had loons definitely wintering and feeding on the bottom of Lake, the Gulf of Mexico, right where this oil would have settled, and this versus would have settled, and contaminated the food chain. And that's why we were looking at the contaminants that birds were bringing back to Minnesota. Now, there were other loons being studied along the Texas coast, and they found out those were from Saskatchewan, but they were not in an area that was affected by the oil spill. So the Saskatchewan origin birds wintering offshore from Texas did not receive the same level of concern as the Minnesota loons. Next, we looked at migration patterns and wintering distribution of the juvenile loons. And as I mentioned, this was brand new, never been done before. This is what those young loons look like. We have the lake. Have to wait until late summer until they're full size, and they're all grayish with a real pretty scaly pattern over their back. And at the time of the oil spill, we had young loons from 2008, also from 2009, that were affected by the spill, as well as any adult loons that may have been still in the Gulf at that time, although I think a lot of the adults would have probably been heading north by then. We also had a grad student come from Iceland to join us one summer and learn how to study and capture loons, because he wanted to learn how to study loons in Iceland. So this had a nice little international dimension to it. And then I'm still awake at the end of the night to catch loons. And it's one of those things where it's so exciting. You just keep on going through the night. And on a good night, you might catch 3, 4, 5 loons. So there's one of the young ones. It's measured. And this is the geolocator. This is a marvelous little piece of equipment. It's about half the size of a AAA battery, half the length of a AAA. And it measures temperature and pressure and light. It's not as accurate as a satellite transmitter, but the satellite transmitter doesn't measure items. Well, as with the adults, we had to put the loons under. They got their operation and they got their little transmitter. So now we've got our radio controlled juvenile loons. But the catch is that you can't pick up all the data from a satellite now. You have to go back the next year and try to catch the same loon. Now, in the case of the juveniles, they're not going to come back the next year. The only ones you can do this on are the adults. So they come back to the same territory, and for the adults that we put geolocators on, we could capture them and then actually plug in the terminals on the geolocator and download all the data onto a laptop computer right on the boat. So it's pretty slick. And then you can go back to the lab and download all of this information that's been accumulating for a whole year. And then we have to expose the loon to a little bit of indignity. We do a fecal swab. Now, what that fecal swab will tell you is that it will contain the DNA of all the fish species that the loon has eaten in recent times. And then if you take a water sample from the spot where that loon was captured, the water will give you the DNA of all the species present right there. So you can compare what the loon ate compared to what's in the water there. Present. So we got 15 loons the first year, 2014. Young loons have a very high mortality rate. They just do a lot of things that are not very healthy. They run into power lines and some die from red tide off the Florida coast.
They think the red tide has something to do.
It will kill some. And we have some that get shot by loose hunters here in places like Arkansas. But since these birds had satellite transmitters, we were able to have people down south go out and pick up the dead loon and retrieve the transmitter, because these are about $3,000 each. So we were able to recover the transmitters, and then we outfitted 7 more loons the next year so we could boost up the sample size. So that's why we ended up with 22 young loons in the study. We learned that the adults migrate independently from the chicks. The parents usually migrate first, leaving the chicks behind. You're on your own. And then the young remain on their breeding area lakes after the adults leave until freeze up, sometimes time in November, and then they go south. So they're not following parents. They're just striking out with basic instincts. And how they know that? They got some kind of internal GPS. It's pretty amazing. And this is a comparison of adult moon wintering areas on the left and juveniles on the right. The juveniles winter much closer to shore in shallower water. So it's a different type of food source that are used by the juveniles. Okay, now here's the migration pattern, brand new information, what we learned from the juveniles. They don't go to the Great Lakes, basically. They're really anxious to just head for the beach in Florida. They go about 2 or 3 days, a couple stops, they're on the beach. See, they're stopping in Illinois, Kentucky, Tennessee. So they still ended up mostly in the Gulf of Mexico. We have one that went all the way down to northeastern Mexico and then onto the Florida Gulf Coast, right there. The gray spots mean that loon died. This, the one at the top was shot by a goose hunter. The one down here, that was red tide. They had several different things that affected them. But we had a surprising amount of mortality. So mortality is high that first year, and then it drops until when you get to an adult moon, 3, 4, 5 years old, they're really good survivors. So now we're in February, the birds are all pretty much in their winter locations. And this is where we didn't know where they go. We thought maybe they stayed in the Gulf for 3 years, but we weren't sure. Okay, now we're into mid-March. We didn't know what was going to happen here in April. Oops, something's happening. They're getting restless. They're heading north. So what did they do? They're striking out to the northeast, into the Atlantic, moving north-northeast along the coast, way out in the coast. These are like teenagers exploring in a new park. We have one up and end up in the Gulf of St. Lawrence. So we had three, now we're at June 15th. So this is where they spent their first summer. We had a bird in Quebec, New Brunswick, Nova Scotia. This had never been known before. We had no clue. Nobody knows. So then the big mystery is, well, what do they do next? Do they go back to the Gulf or do they stay there? Well, the next year, they went right back down to the Gulf Coast again in the wintertime. And then this year, in the summer of their second year, instead of going back to the Gulf of St. Lawrence, one went offshore from South Carolina, and one went to northwestern Ontario. Totally, totally different pattern from the year before. So then they were going to go back again. Okay, there's the last moon with a functioning radio. February 27th, the spring, and they were just dying of anxiety because if it lasted just another month or two, we'd see where it goes in Minnesota. And the radio died about the middle of March, right before it left. So we're asking people up in the Tamarack National Wildlife Refuge to please watch for a radio mark, loon. And then the geolocators, they assess the diving behavior, feeding behavior, and give you an incredible amount of information beyond just locating. So we've done 94 loons. We have a success rate of about 37% recovery. So it's, these are, they don't like being caught a second time. And what you can get from that is when you read the depths, this is the loon living in its Minnesota lake. This gap, that's when it was in the air, migrating to Lake Michigan through the middle. First half of that is northern Lake Michigan, the second half is southern Lake Michigan, and right here is when it migrated to the Gulf of Mexico, and the last set of bars is in the Gulf of Mexico. So they're feeding at 30 feet, 100 feet, 140, 50 feet, and then the Gulf of Mexico maybe 110 feet, right on the bottom. So this was another key piece of information that the Fish and Wildlife Service needed to link the contamination from the oil spill to to our loons. And then this is, each of these big bars is a daytime activity of diving. And when you split that out by time, here you can see that a given loon, it dived to the bottom about 7 times in a half hour. So they come up, get a breath of air, go right back down there, just feeding continuously. It's an amazing process by which they capture fruit. You'd think there'd be some fish closer to the surface, but apparently not the kind they like. And then we had Chris Perkins out of the University of Connecticut doing our analyses. I just got another batch of data from him like a day ago, so I haven't had a chance to go over that yet. But we had to look at blood, feathers, fat, and eggs. The fat came from the dead loons that people had turned in. We got the eggs as unhatched eggs that people turned in where the loons left the nest before the chicks hatched. This is your chemistry lesson for the day. Polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. That's the petroleum contaminants. Now there are some that are just naturally found in the Gulf that ooze up from the bottom, but there are others that were specific to the oil spill. The bad thing about those is that they're cancer-causing, they cause genetic mutations, all kinds of weird effects in development. And then Corexit that was dumped on the water as a dispersant, 800,000 to a million gallons, it also causes huge problems. Respiratory, nervous system, liver, kidney, blood disorders, it causes cancer, hormone disruption, and EPA says it's an acute health hazard. So why they felt they had to dump that in the Gulf is kind of a mystery to me. And then if you want to scare yourself really good, go to your local drugstore and look for stool softeners. It's the same stuff. I think I would rather be constipated. Yes. I haven't looked at any of that. I don't know about the fish. This is what we found in the four kinds of sampling. Blood, about 29% of the blood from Minnesota loons captured in Minnesota contained the petroleum contaminants. The fat, about 27%. The feathers, 14%. The eggs, about 18%. So even the eggs were being contaminated after the loons got back to Minnesota. These cancer-causing agents were also being passed on in the eggs. So how much that might affect their hatchability or their survivability, we really can't say. This was an interesting comparison. These are 8 loons that were caught by the USGS team. The middle column means non-detected. These are 8 loons the year before the oil spill. There were no contaminants, no PA agents. The year after the oil spill, 5 of the 8 had the petroleum contamination present. So it was a pretty strong suggestion that this was something coming from the oil spill and not just natural contamination. The DOS contamination, again, it wasn't as high a percentage, but it was in the blood, about 15% fat, 10.5%, feathers, 8.6%, eggs, 1.8%. So now this broke down faster. Most of it was gone after about 3 years, but it was still another contaminant in the birds. And here's our local friend, Ken, out sampling loons, Ken Perry. Since 1994, we've had an annual loon monitoring program on 600 lakes in Minnesota, 100 lakes in each kind of different habitat type. And this was our long-term way of looking at loon populations because you can't draw conclusions from a single lake or just several lakes. It has to be scientifically designed. So we have these index areas, and this is Itasca index area. You can see that there's maybe a slight decline, but nothing of any dramatic trend. So we haven't seen anything happen as a result of the oil spill that suggests we're losing loons because it takes so long for them to enter the breeding population, 5 years, that if something did change, it would take a while for us to get that many loons showing a population trend. So this is the point where we're at right now. We've done all the research, we put all the data together, we've got a pretty good indication that the loons were directly affected by the spill, and some of our loons would have been those that died in the spill. So these are the federal acts that were involved in designing what they call remediation, which means restoration. And so just 1 month ago today, I was busy pecking away at the computer, submitting a plan for $6 million to do loon conservation work over the next 3 years using some of the money. Now, BP put $18 billion with a B in a remediation account for the Fish and Wildlife Service for all different kinds of wildlife and habitats that were affected. $70 million was put in what was called an open ocean account for species like loons and northern gannets and other species that